Smash Bros. A video game with no real meaning behind the game, right? I mean, after all, this platform fighter is just about Nintendo Universe characters getting together to randomly brawl and appease our inner Nintendo nerddom souls. But is that really all there is to the game? Did Sakurai leave it at that? This is a question I have recently started to ponder and really try to understand. I have began having more open conversations with friends who love the series as well to see if they know something more about the game or something to bring more depth to this wonderful melting pot of characters I love. After conversation upon conversation, it finally happened. A friend of mine told me he had some deep insight into some more lore about this very question I was pondering. As he started to explain this to me, my excitement grew and grew, but then I stopped him and said, "Please, please film this. I would love to share this information with my friends and family. Please thank my friend Matt for all this information and deciding to learn how to edit and make videos while doing so in this process." And he did all this just for Superhero Game Squad. Welcome to some deep information I never knew to be true about Super Smash Brothers.
I have distinct memories of the first time that I played Sims as a young kid. With the powers of a god and the responsibility of caring for these little virtual beings, I was more preoccupied with exploring the limits of my powers. I promptly built four walls around my hapless victim and proceeded to replace the four tiles with water. And as I waited for him to drown, I became impatient and lit the area on fire. I learned a few things that day. For one, my curiosity would render me a poor god, but beyond that, there's a unique relationship that created beings and deities share. A writer is like a god to his story, able to change and influence things as he sees fit, and children are like gods when they play with their toys. Dolls and action figures are imbued with life and persona, and when the game is over, they are just as suddenly rendered lifeless and inert. The full span of their imaginary lives begins and ends at the whims of a playful god. Creation and destruction are just a part of the game. Video games are not unfamiliar with this relationship either. While a lot of games I talk about deal with deity from the perspective of the created beings, wherein gods are seen as lofty, untouchable, and immutable beings of divine strength, some games approach this subject from the other side. In fact, there is an entire genre of games dedicated toward taking on this godly role. Sims, Spore, ActRaiser, Populous, Black and White. The tone of these games is quite different, because the role you occupy of a supreme being is not lofty or unattainable. You already have it. And the created beings you oversee are nothing but toys or playthings. There's one series I feel that carries the tone and setting of a god game, yet puts you in the role of the toys. The entire framework for the Super Smash Bros. Lore and theology is set up in the opening scene of the first game. A floating white-gloved hand in a child's bedroom. It grabs action figures from its toy chest and sets them up for a game of pretend. And in that moment, imagination transforms the toys into combatants who will do battle with one another. We all already know the series so well that we may take it for granted, but this setup would seem to suggest that we as players would take on the role of the master hand. But as we approach the end of the single player campaign, we realize that this isn't the case. The final boss is against that floating hand from the intro. We aren't the creator playing with his toys. We are the toys. And even if we win, our only reward is being transformed back into a doll or action figure. It was all just a game. What I'm getting at is, this would all be really interesting and compelling even if the Master Hand was presented as a true, lofty deity with godlike status, and we as characters represented here as creatures beneath him. But what we get is actually a role lower than that, as objects underneath created beings. And the God of our universe is probably just a created being here on this level. So the game kind of sets up this analogous relationship between gods and creatures, and creatures and objects. And that's just a really interesting premise for a game. The trophy descriptions for Master Hand in each game detail his godly nature as a symbolic link between the real world and the imaginary battlefield. And Brawl describes him as a being tied to the link between this world, where the trophies fight, and the world beyond. The meaning of his existence is unknown, as are his goals, but he seems to have obtained and kept hidden a power that borders on absolute. This is pretty cool, because just like a child's hands act as the medium between his real self and his imagined world of play, so too do many religions and mythologies use the same language to describe deities' interactions with the physical world. The Rig Veda says, "Where is that gracious hand of thine, O Rudra, the hand that giveth health and bringeth comfort?" And even in the cases where gods aren't given corporeal form, they still sometimes anthropomorphize those deities as having hands that can reach into the mortal plane. The Book of Jeremiah, and in many other places, refers to the hands of God as interacting with the physical world like a potter's hands interact with clay. Even God games frequently use hands as your pointer, and so it'd be fitting for Super Smash Bros. To use a hand as the avatar for its imaginary world's deity. But as many of you know, Master Hand isn't simply one deity, but a pair of them, a duality. On the one hand, literally, we have the creative force of imagination, and on the other hand, also literally, we have the destructive force. Where Master Hand loves to create, his alter ego is impulsive and destructive, consumed with that hollow feeling which comes from destroying one's own creations. And Brawl puts it, a seeming manifestation of the destructive spirit in the direct contrast to Master Hand, who is the manifestation of the creative spirit. And Smash 4 puts it simply, Crazy Hand embodies destruction in the Super Smash Bros. Universe. It's important to note that based on how these two fight in concert with one another, their relationship isn't antagonistic. And therefore, it's not really accurate to compare them to enemies like devas and asuras in Hinduism, or gods and demons, or even Ahura Mazda and Ingra Mainru in Zoroastrianism. Rather, they seem to be more like Brahman and Shiva of Hinduism, the creator and destroyer deities respectively, who work together to keep the cycle of creation and destruction ongoing. In Hinduism, the universe is created and lasts for 4.32 billion years, whereupon it's dissolved and will remain dissolved for 4.32 billion years, only to be remade anew. Creation and destruction working together to maintain the cycle of play for the universe. Or, if you want a pop culture example, I guess the Supreme Kais and the Gods of Destruction from Dragon Ball Super will do you just fine too. As I mentioned earlier, we see this play out in the Super Smash Bros. Series as well. When your character overcomes Master Hand at the end of the game, the character simply reverts back to its inanimate form, waiting to be animated again for the next battle. The cycle repeats itself like a game. Creative and destructive forces are not locked in an immortal battle to defeat each other, but just engaging in a drama, a play, a game, or a dance. In Shaiva Hinduism, it's called the Tandava, or the cosmic dance of Nataraja Shiva. And in Vaishnava Hinduism, and others, the whole of the created universe is just God at play, or Leela. It's a fascinating concept that we might touch on again if we ever cover Dissidia Final Fantasy, so I'll pause that for now. So yes, there are a lot of interesting religious tones and themes placed into the Super Smash Bros. Universe, but put simply, Master Hand is just someone playing with his favorite characters. The role he assumes is a godly one, but his interests are grounded, relatable, and pretty clear. A quick look around his room, or at his toys, should tell you what he's into. Master Hand is a gamer, and obviously a big Nintendo fan. He plays video games, he was collecting amiibos before collecting amiibos was a thing, and even the attacks he uses are apparently inspired by the attacks he's seen bosses use in games like Mario 64, Kirby Superstar, Star Fox 64, and Zelda Ocarina of Time. With Super Smash Bros. Being announced for the Switch, it looks like we'll all be lucky enough to continue to be the playthings of this master deity for years to come.